In the last class, we have discussed limit state method and some ISCO documentation we have studied, and we found how to calculate the compressive strength of concrete. As well as we have seen how to calculate the modulus of elasticity for the concrete, and we found it is equal to, as per the ISCO documentation, the initial tangent modulus, we generally take 5000 under root FCK. We also seen the flexural tensile strength of the concrete equal to 0.7 under root FCK. This modulus of elasticity we have studied for the short term. If you want to consider the creep effect, then we have studied the long term effect, and we have found the modulus of elasticity of concrete considering the creep effect is equal to 5000 under root FCK divided by 1 plus theta. And we have solved the gate problems which were asked in the last years. Now we are going to start the main topic, the second chapter, limit state of collapse in flexure. Torsion, limit state of collapse in shear, and the limit state of collapse in compression. Today we are going to start the limit state of collapse in flexure. The flexure term indicates means there is a bending moment. We will be discussing about the bending moment, and definitely if you want to design the beam, it will be subjected to the bending moment. So let's start with the assumptions. There are some assumptions we have prepared in the limit state of collapse in flexure. The assumption number first, plane section remains plane before and after the bending. This is our first assumption. The plane section remains plane before and after the bending. What is the meaning of this assumption? Suppose I am having one beam. This is the beam, and suppose the load is coming. Due to this load, the deflected shape of the beam will be something like this, right? Now what I need to do here, see, suppose I have taken one cross section. See, these are the cross section. This is the dotted line showing the one section I have taken. If the same points, if I locate here, what will happen? I have taken some points on the beam. So after the bending, suppose these were my initial points. These were my initial points which I have drawn here after the bending. And suppose this is the neutral axis. This is the neutral axis. So what will happen after the bending? When the bending is there due to the dead load or live load or any other external load, so due to this bending, the fibers get shifted somewhere here. In this way. So if I connect these points, I'll be getting one line which is linear. So we can say here, the plane sections remains plane before and after the bending. That means this statement says the variation in the strain is linear. The variation in the strain is linear. If I draw the strain distribution, the variation in the strain is linear from top. Here I am getting the compressive strain from top to fiber, it is linear, and here I am getting the tensile strain. So this assumption says the strain variation in the beam is linear from top to bottom, and it changes its sign from compression to the tension phase. So this is our first assumption. The plane sections remains plane before and after the bending. It was vertical in the first case without bending. Now after the bending, it remains, the surface remains plane, but the variation in the strain is linear. Now let me discuss the second assumption. Assumption number two. This was our first assumption. Now assumption number two. Side by side, you can write, you can note down all the assumptions. Our second assumption, the maximum compressive strain in the concrete shall be taken as 0.0035. In flexure, as per the assumption, if there is a condition of flexure, there is a condition of bending moment, in that case, we can take the maximum compressive strain in my concrete equal to 0.0035. What is the meaning of this statement? Suppose we are preparing, what is the meaning of this 0.0035? Because after this strain, we have observed the cracks in our concrete, that's why we have limited the strain up to the 0.0035. Suppose, this is the stress strain curve. This is the stress strain curve for my concrete. Generally, if I see the idealized curve, it will be something like this. But if you see the, as per the IS code 456-2000, they have taken the curve. First, they have taken the curve parabolic up to the strain of 0.002, and after that, they have taken the linear line, a straight constant stress, they have taken up to the 0.0035. So this one, if I draw with the red line, it is the actual curve, and this one is your suggested by IS 456. So this curve is your parabolic, this portion is your parabolic, and this is your straight. Suppose this curve I have drawn for FCK, the characteristic compressive strength. In the last class, we have discussed what is the characteristic compressive strength. As per the characteristic compressive strength of concrete, we consider the chances of failure is 5%. One more curve I am drawing here. It is also parabolic up to the strain of 0.002, and then again it is straight up to the strain of 0.0035. Here I am dividing the FCK by 1.5 equal to 0.67 FCK. Suppose one more curve I am drawing here. It is also parabolic up to the strain of 0.002 and straight up to the strain of 0.0035, and this 0.67 FCK again I am dividing by 1.5, I will be getting 0.446 FCK. This is the stress strain curve for my concrete. Now let me define what is the meaning of this FCK, 0.67 FCK and 0.446 FCK. This is your actual curve actually. Actual. Here you can see FCK equal to, actually FCK is characteristic compressive strength of concrete. What is 0.67 FCK? 0.67 FCK is the characteristic compressive strength of concrete in structure. So we can write here, strength of concrete in structure. What is the meaning of the strength of concrete in the structure. So let me define. See, this is the FCK, the characteristic compressive strength of concrete after the curing of 28 days. How I test this FCK? I prepare one cube of 15 by 15 by 15 centimeter cube. And I test this cube in a compression testing machine. What I did, so first of all, I have prepared my concrete. I prepared a cube of 15 by 15 by 15. And then, after the 28 days of curing, I kept my cube into the compression testing machine. This is the plate over which I kept my cube and I applied the load. This is the load plate. I am applying the load. So what will happen? Your concrete block, your cube is confined between two plates. So here your cube is getting only the compressive stresses. But if you talk about a real structure where suppose the one beam is there. So in the case of beam, there will be one plate from the top, which is your nothing but your slab. It will apply the load on the beam. But there is no any plate or the support from the bottom. So definitely your beam will be getting deflection, will be facing the problem of bending moment. In the case of column, it is getting the compressive forces. Of course, sometimes the bending moment, your beam may be subjected to the torsional moment in the structure. So considering all the effects of these forces, maybe torsion moment, maybe the bending moment, axial forces, compressive forces, shear stresses. So considering all these forces, we have taken only the 0.67% strength of my concrete. Because FCK is the compressive strength of concrete due to the compressive load only. But in the structure, all these kind of the forces will be coming. So I need to consider some factor of safety. It's not actually the partial factor of safety, but some safety I need to consider to take the effect of all these forces. That's why I have taken only the 67% strength in my concrete, in my structure. What is 0.446 FCK? 0.446 FCK is the design strength of my concrete in the structure. Design strength of concrete. So this is actually your partial factor 1.5. This is your 1.5, means a partial factor of safety for design purpose. In the last class, we have seen in the limit state of collapse, in the limit state method actually, we consider the factor of safety for concrete equal to 1.5. And for the steel, we consider 1.15. So this is your second assumption. As per the second assumption, we take the design strength equal to 0.446 FCK and the maximum compressive strain in my concrete in bending equal to 0.0035. When we'll be discussing about the compression members, means the columns, the maximum compressive strain will be something different. It will not be this 0.0035. That will be something different because there we'll be discussing about only the compressive forces. But here, we are interested in the bending moment. That's why we have taken the maximum compressive strain 0.0035 in flexure. This was our second assumption. Now next assumption, assumption number 3. As per the assumption number 3, the stress block, let me define. The assumption number 3, the stress block for concrete is considered parabolic up to the strain of 0.002 and then constant and straight up to the strain 0.0035. What I mean to say here, I have drawn that figure. This is the strain distribution as per my first assumption. The strain distribution, the strain variation is linear and the maximum is 0.0035. Here suppose your depth of neutral axis and suppose this is your 0.002. The strain at the neutral axis is zero. So if I want to draw the stress block, satisfy this assumption number 3, I have seen up to the 0.002 strain from here to here. It is parabolic. This is parabolic. And after that, it is constant and straight up to the strain of 0.0035. This is straight. And it will give the design strength 0.446 FCK. Done. Next assumption. Assumption number 4. As per assumption number 4, tensile strength of the concrete is ignored. The tensile strength of my concrete is ignored. What is the meaning of this statement? The meaning is, so definitely there will be tensile stresses below the neutral axis in my beam, right? And there is a concrete below the neutral axis in the beam. So definitely the concrete is getting the tensile stresses. But we have provided the tensile reinforcement in my beam. So I, through this assumption, I assume all the tensile stresses which are coming due to the external loads will be taken by steel only. So as per this assumption, I can say all the tensile stresses will be taken by tensile reinforcement steel. That's why you should observe here, I have drawn the stress block for the concrete above the neutral axis only. You should notice here, you people should notice here, I have drawn only the stress block above the neutral axis. This is your neutral axis. I have not drawn any value of stress block below the neutral axis because I consider my concrete to be cracked below the neutral axis as per the crack section theory, and I do not consider the tensile strength of my concrete because I have considered already all the tensile stresses, all the tensile forces will be taken by steel only. That's why I have provided the steel in my beam. This is my assumption number 4. Let's talk about assumption number 5. As per the assumption number 5, the maximum strain in steel shall not be less than 0.002 plus 0.87 Fy by Es. Right? This already we have discussed in the last class, how to find this strain value in the steel, that already we have seen. So as per the assumption number 5 of the IS-456-2000 in the limited state of collapse in flexure, the steel shall possess a minimum strain of 0.002 plus 0.87 Fy by Es. The statement says the maximum strain in the steel shall not be less than 0.002.875 by Es. That means it is the minimum value of strain that the steel shall possess. Right? So this way we have discussed all the assumptions which are required in the limited state of collapse in flexure. If you have discussed the assumptions, so based on these assumptions, now we can analyze our singly reinforced beam easily. So let me start the analysis of singly reinforced beam section. Analysis of, here I can write, analysis of singly reinforced section. So suppose there is a one beam, the width of the beam is suppose small b, and I have provided the reinforcement in the bottom of my beam. The effective depth of the beam is suppose d, that is small d. The effective depth is always measured from the top of the beam to the CG of the centroid of the main reinforcement. That's why I drawn from top of the beam to the CG of the main reinforcement. This is called effective depth of the beam. If I take the depth of the beam from the top of the beam to the bottom of the beam, this is called the gross depth. I am interested up to the CG of the reinforcement because the tensile forces, I have assumed all the tensile stresses will be taken by steel. So for the analysis purpose, if I want to calculate the tensile forces, so definitely I'll be calculating at the level of steel, right? So that's why I have drawn up to the here. And I'm interested up to the here only because I need to calculate the tensile forces in the steel. If you see here, assumption number first, we have discussed in assumption number first, the plane section remains plane before and after the bending. That means your strain variation in the beam is linear and it changes its sign from compression to the tension. So this is the variation of your strain. And somewhere here, suppose this is the depth of the neutral axis. The depth of the neutral axis means where all the tensile stresses become equal to the total compressive stresses. So this is called your depth of neutral axis. The strain variation is linear, and I have discussed the maximum compressive strain in my concrete I will be taking equal to 0.0035. And as per the assumption number 5, we have written this strain in the steel is equal to 0.002 plus 0.8785 by ES. So in this way we have prepared the strain variation across the depth. Now let's discuss the stress block. We have discussed, see, suppose this is the strain of 0.002. So if I draw here, so as per my assumption, I know the stress block is considered to be parabolic up to the strain of 0.002, and then it's considered straight and constant up to the strain of 0.0035, that is at the top fiber. And the design stress, the design strength of concrete is taken 0.446 FCK. If I want to analyze this figure, you should see here. Suppose this is your distance x1, and suppose this is your distance x2. This is the total depth of the neutral axis, xu. Xu is the total depth of the neutral axis. X1 is the distance between the neutral axis and the strain up to the 0.002. And x2 is the distance between the 0.002 strain up to the 0.0035 strain. Can I find x1 and x2 using a similar triangular property in this figure? Yes, I can find. How to find? See, I can apply a similar triangular property here, that is 0.0035 divided by xu equal to 0.002 divided by x1. So from here I can calculate x1 equal to 4 by 7 of xu. I know x1 plus x2 equal to xu. So from here, if x1 is known, I will be able to calculate x2, that is equal to 3 by 7 of xu. So in this way, I have calculated the value of x1 and x2. So I can write the value of x1 and x2 here. This is your x2, is nothing but 3 by 7 of your xu. And this is the distance of x1, which is nothing but equal to the 4 by 7 of your xu. Right? Now let's start the analysis of the stress block. You can see here, from the neutral axis to 0.002 strain, it is parabolic. And then it is straight up to the top fiber of 0.0035 strain. It is an irregular figure, I cannot analyze. So what I need to do here, I can divide this figure into two parts. First is your parabolic portion and second is your rectangular portion. So what I did, suppose your parabolic portion is applying the force C1 and the rectangular portion is applying a force C2. Definitely, suppose this is my beam, this is the length of, this is span of the beam, though definitely the compressive forces are acting along the length of the beam, above the neutral axis. So, here C1 and C2 are acting. I can calculate the value of C1 and C2. Let's calculate C1. What is the value of C1? The area of the stress block will be equal to the force. So, C1 equal to 2/3 of the area of parabola is 2/3 of the area of rectangular. So, 2/3 of width of the beam into this distance is your x2. Sorry, this distance is your x1, which is equal to 4/7 of xu. So, this distance is your x1. This is the total area of parabola into stress. And the stress is nothing but 0.446 fck. So, 0.446 fck. This is the total area and this is the total force. I know 2/3 into b into x1 value I have already calculated. That is the 4/7 of your xu. So, 4/7 of xu into 0.446 fck. Let's calculate C2. C2 is a rectangular portion. The rectangular portion of the stress block will be giving the force C2. So, C2 equal to area of this block is B into X2, right? B is the width of the beam and X2 is this distance. This X2 is nothing but 3/7 of XU into, again, stress, that is 0.446 FCK. So, this C2 force is equal to B into X2 already I have calculated. This X2 equal to 3/7 of XU. So, 3/7 of XU. 0.446 FCK. So, in this way, we can calculate C1 and C2. If I have to calculate the total force, definitely the total force will be equal to C1 plus C2. So, C equal to C1 plus C2. If I add these two terms, C1 and C2, I'll be getting C equal to 0.36 FCK B into XU. This is your total compressive forces acting above the neutral axis. This is the total compressive forces acting above the neutral axis. So, this is suppose the beam and this is the depth of the neutral axis. See, this is the half portion is the depth of the neutral axis. So, your compressive forces are acting along the length of the beam above the neutral axis. But I do not know the location of this C. The total depth of neutral axis is XU. So, where this C is acting, that is the big question for me. So, let's calculate the location of C, where actually this C is acting. Before that, we will discuss how to calculate. See, we have calculated the total tensile compressive forces. Now, we need to calculate the total tensile forces. So, compressive forces are acting in this direction. So, definitely in the opposite direction, tensile forces will be acting. Suppose total tensile force is T. And I know the location of my tensile force. Yes, your tensile force will be acting at the CG of my reinforcement. Right? Along the length of the beam only, but along at the level of reinforcement, these tensile forces will be acting. Because already I have considered all the tensile forces will be taken by steel only. I ignore the tensile strength of my concrete. So here, I can calculate the total tensile force. Total tensile force equal to T equal to force equal to stress into area. Suppose I have provided area of reinforcement AST. AST means area of reinforcement. Suppose I have provided. So I know stress in my steel, that is yield strength, not Fy into AST. Stress into area. In as per IS code, I need to consider the factor of safety for this strength is 1.15 in the steel. So it is 1.15. So the total tensile force equal to 0.87 Fy ST. Now I am having total compressive forces in the total tensile forces in my beam. I know the location of T. It is acting at the CG of the reinforcement, but I do not know the location of my C. I do not know the total compressive forces which are going to act. Suppose the total compressive forces, I need to calculate the location of this C, where these total compressive forces are going to act. So let me assume, suppose here C2 is acting at the distance of B and your C1 suppose is acting at a distance of A. Your C1 is acting at a distance of A from the top fiber, and the C2 is acting at the distance of B from the top fiber. So can I calculate the location of total C? Suppose the X bar is equal to C1A1 plus C2A2, C1A into C2B, C1A into C2B divided by C1 plus C2. This is the formula to calculate the location of total compressive force from the top fiber. So how to calculate A and B? So we have A equal to, see, this is the location of A here somewhere. This is the distance from top fiber to the C1 is A. So A equal to, can I write? This is X2 plus the CG of the parabola from this face is equal to 3 by 8 of X1. I know X2 and X1. So A equal to, what is the value of X2? The value of X2 is 3 by 7 of XU plus 3 by 8, and the value of X1 is 4 by 7 of XU. So in this way, I can calculate the value of A in the terms of depth of neutral axis, that is XU. Now let's calculate for the B. The B is the location of the force C2, which is acting due to this rectangular stress block. And for the stress block, rectangular stress block, the CG is definitely at the here, at the X2 by 2. So if I want to calculate the B, it's nothing but X2 by 2. I know the value of X2, that is equal to 3 by 7 of XU. So let's divide by 2, it will be giving me 3 by 14 XU. So now I'm having the value of A, and I'm having the value of B. So I can calculate now X bar. If you put the value of A here, the value of B here, C1 and C2 already we have calculated. You put all the values, so definitely you will be getting X bar equal to 0.42 XU. Because all the value we have calculated in the terms of XU, depth of neutral axis. So here X bar value will be 0.42 XU. Now let me draw here. This is the total compressive force C, which is acting at the location of 0.42 XU. The distance of this total C, the distance of this total C is 0.42 XU from the top fiber of the beam. I know this is that my total tensile force. So we can analyze here. This is suppose the beam, and this is the depth of the neutral axis at this particular cross section. Suppose this is the depth of the neutral axis. So above the depth of the neutral axis, the compressive forces are acting along the length of the beam. And below the neutral axis, the tensile forces acting in the opposite direction, definitely in the opposite direction below the depth of the neutral axis. So above the neutral axis, compressive forces, below the neutral axis, tensile forces. So there is a distance between these two forces which will be creating the couple. That is nothing but the bending moment. So what I need to do, I need to calculate the lever arm. The distance between these two compressive forces and the tensile forces is called lever arm. So the total distance I know from here to here, it is effective depth D. So from top fiber to the compressive forces, the distance is 0.42 XU. So the distance between total compressive force to the total tensile force, this distance will be your D minus 0.42 XU. Of course, total is D. If I deduct this 0.42 XU, so I will be getting D minus 0.42 XU. This D minus 0.42 XU is nothing but your lever arm. Lever arm is means it is the distance between the total compressive force to the total tensile force. So in this way, we have calculated the lever arm. So now I am having total compressive force C equal to 0.36 FCK B into SU. I am having total tensile force 0.87 FY into AST. I am also having the lever arm, which is the distance between the total compressive force and the total tensile force, equal to D minus 0.42 XU. Right? This LA means the lever arm. So definitely this lever arm is going to create one, is going to develop one moment. It's called the bending moment. So I can calculate the bending moment I'll be calling moment of resistance. I will not call the bending moment, I will call the moment of resistance. Why? Because here I am dealing with the grade of the concrete. Means the strength of the concrete, strength of the steel. Of course, the dimension, the B and the D. So definitely it is giving me strength, right? It is giving me resistance against the applied forces, applied moments. So I call it as a moment of resistance, MOR. If anywhere I am writing MOR, that means I am writing the moment of resistance. How I can calculate this moment of resistance? This moment of resistance is nothing but C into lever arm. Or it may be your T into lever arm. If I want to calculate the moment of resistance in the compression zone, it will be your C into lever arm. C is your total compressive force into lever arm. So it will be your 0.36 FCK B into XCU into lever arm is B minus 0.42 XCU. If I want to calculate the moment of resistance in the tensile zone, I can calculate T into lever arm. That is nothing but 0.87 FY into ASP into B minus 0.42 XCU. So in this way, I calculate the moment of resistance is my beam. Somebody has asked, why we have taken the 0.0035? Sir, already is the assumption given by the IS 456-2000. We need to consider the maximum compressive strain in the concrete in the flexure is 0.0035 because we have observed in the bending, in the concrete, we observe the cracks at the strain of 0.0035. So immediately we stop the test. When we test the concrete for the flexure condition, we have observed the cracks at the strain of 0.0035. That's why at that time we have stopped our test and we have taken the average value. On an average, they have given the 0.0035 in the flexure condition. So in this way, I calculate the total moment of resistance of my section. Let's solve few problems based on these concepts. Limited set of collapse in flexure. Please see your PPT. Question number first. Read the question carefully and try to give me answer. Get question for civil engineering 1991 for 2 marks. Already formula is there. You need to find the answer. Can you give me answer? So you can see here. The question is, the total compressive forces at the time of failure of a concrete beam of width B without considering the partial safety factor of the material is. They have the total compressive force 0.36 FCK B into XCU. But it is considering the partial safety factor is 1.5. He has asked, don't consider the partial safety factor. So what will be the value of C? Definitely the value of C will be into 1.5. Because this we have calculated considering 1.5. We have divided by 1.5. We have divided our 0.67 FCK. Okay, let me write here clearly. See, we have considered the strength of concrete in the structure is 0.67 FCK and we have divided by 1.5 and we got the 0.446 FCK. This already we have discussed. Now the question is, don't consider, this is the partial safety factor. The question is, don't consider the factor of safety and calculate the compressive forces. So considering this factor of safety, I got the total compressive force of 0.36 FCK B into XCU. If I don't consider, means I need to multiply here. So, for this particular question, my answer should be C equal to 1.5 into 0.36 FCK B into XU. So, definitely I will be getting 0.54 FCK B into XU. So, this is the answer. Answer B. Option B. Right? So, in this way you can calculate. It's a very easy question. Get 1991. One more question is there. Please read the question carefully. So answer is C. Yeah, answer is C. This is nothing but the assumption you have considered. The strain variation is linear and it will change its sign from top fiber to the bottom fiber, from compression to the tension. Next question. Get 2015 for 1 mark. They have given the beam. And they asked, this was the beam, and this is the question now. The question is, at the section XX, which of the following statement is true at the limit state? The first option is, the variation of stress is linear and that of strain is not linear. But we know the variation in the strain is linear and the stress block is first parabolic and then straight. So your option number A is wrong. Second option B, the variation of strain is linear and that of stress is not linear. Yes, definitely the variation of strain is linear and the stress block, I know it's a parabolic and then it is straight, which is your non-linear. So your answer is B. For this particular question, your answer is B. Get 2015 for 1 mark. Very important question based on assumptions only. Next question. It's a very interesting question. Get 2003 for 2 marks. The question is, calculate the maximum strains at the tough fiber of the beam and at the level of reinforcement. Means I need to calculate the compressive strain in my concrete and the total tensile strain in my steel. So as per the assumption of limit state of collapse in flexure, I know the maximum compressive strain in the concrete in flexure shall be considered as 0.0035. If I want to draw the strain diagram, the variation of strain, it will be something like this. The maximum compressive strain at this tough fiber will be 0.0035. And at the level of tensile reinforcement, it will be your 0.002 plus 0.87 Fi by Es. I can calculate the strain on the tough fiber, means in the concrete I know. Let's calculate in the steel, and it is equal to 0.002 plus 0.87, that Fi means they have given the grade 415, and the modulus of elasticity they have given 2 into 10 to the power 5 Newton per mm square. They are given in kilonewton per mm square. We can calculate in newton per mm square. That is nothing but 2 into 10 to the power 5. So it will give me the value 0.0038, nearly equal to 0.0038. So my answer is A. My answer should be A. So strain in concrete is equal to 0.0035. Strain in the steel is equal to 0.0038. Now let's solve the next problem. Get 2005 for 2 marks. So as per the limit state of collapse in flexure, we have drawn the figure first parabolic and then straight. The parabolic up to the 0.002 and the straight up to the strain of 0.0035. As per the IS 456 2000, this is the stress strain curve for my concrete. So according to this, I have drawn my stress block in this fashion. Right? The total stress here is 0.446 FCK. But in the question they have given, instead of considering this parabolic portion, consider the straight line, means a rectangular distribution. Means this time they have suggested, don't use this parabolic distribution in the parabolic portion, consider a triangular portion. And same up to the strain of 0.002 to 0.0035. And don't consider the factor of safety of 1.5. Consider the factor of safety 1, means here your stresses will be 0.67 FCK. This 0.446 FCK we have calculated by dividing 0.67 FCK by 1.5. Now we are not dividing, we are dividing by 1, means we are getting the same value, 0.67 FCK. Now let's analyze and calculate the total compressive forces and the total tensile forces. Get 2005 for 2 marks. The question is, This is your question. This is continued actually. They have given. So for this case, your stress distribution, the stress block will be triangular up to the strain of 0.002 and then straight up to the tough fiber. This will be a stress block. This is the total depth of the neutral axis. Below this, I do not consider the strength of my concrete. So all the calculation I will be doing up to the depth of neutral axis only for concrete. So let's calculate. So I think this is clear how I am drawing this stress block for this particular case. So let's calculate. See, they have given a rectangular beam. They have given a rectangular beam of width 300 mm and the effective depth 500 mm. Width is 300 mm. And we have provided three reinforcement of 16 mm diameter. Three bars of 16 mm diameter. The total effective depth they have given 500 mm. Suppose this is the depth of the neutral axis. The variation of strain I can draw, and it's nothing but 0.0035, and here somewhere it is 0.002. Here I can calculate 0.002 plus 0.87 Fy by ES. Let's calculate the, let's draw the stress block. This is your stress block for this particular case. So again, I am dividing this figure into two parts. First is your rectangular portion. Suppose it is applying the force C2 and this is a triangular force applying the force C1. And this is applying the total tensile force T. The grade of concrete they have given M20. And the reinforcement grade is Fe415. Now the question is, calculate the depth of the neutral axis. The question is calculate the depth of the neutral axis. How to calculate the depth of the neutral axis? See, I can put C equal to T, total compressive force equal to total tensile force, to calculate the depth of the neutral axis. So first of all, we need to calculate here the total compressive force. So total compressive force, I know C1 plus C2. So here C1 is equal to half. This is the area of triangle I need to calculate. This distance I already calculated from the similar triangular property of this variation figure. It is actually equal to 4 by 7 of XU. This is suppose your total depth of the neutral axis XU. Definitely this distance will be your 3 by 7 of XU. So already we have discussed how to calculate S1 and S2. So total C1 is equal to half width of the beam into height is 4 by 7 of XU. So this is equal to, here I can calculate. And the value of this total compressive strength is 0.67 FCK. So half B 4 by 7 XU, this is the total area, into strength is 0.67 FCK. All the parameters are known except XU. So half B, they have given 300 mm into 4 by 7 of XU into 0.67 FCK. The grade of concrete they have given 20 Newton per mm square. This is your C1. Now let's calculate C2. C2 I can calculate. C2 is the area of rectangular portion. And you can find the area is B into 3 by 7 of XU. Into stress is 0.67 FCK. So here B I know is 300 mm given to me. Into 3 by 7 of XU into 0.67. Again FCK is 20. So in this way I calculate total C1 and the total C2. In the terms of XU, if I add total C equal to C1 plus C2, I will be getting 2871.43 XU. Please check C equal to C1 plus C2, calculate total value of C1, calculate total value of C2 in the terms of XU, and put C equal to C1 plus C2, you will be getting total C. Yeah, somebody is asking why we have taken the 0.67 FCK. So, sir, we have taken 0.67 FCK, the strength of concrete in the structure. You are asking for this particular case, or you are asking why we have taken 0.67 FCK in my assumption? I think you are asking for this particular case. Here they have given in the question, you see here, you see your PPT, they have given the partial factor of safety as 1. They have given the partial safety factor equal to 1. That's why I have not considered 0.446 FCK. I have considered only the strength of my concrete in structure, considering all the effect of the forces. Because FCK I have taken only for compressive load in my compression testing machine. That's why I need to take smaller value, because in this structure, not only the compressive force will come, other forces also will come. So I need to consider all the effect of these forces. That's why I have taken 67% strength of my concrete. And for this particular question, I have taken 0.67 FCK because they have given the factor of safety equal to 1. If you don't give any value, that means I need to consider factor of safety 1.5. So I'll be considering the value 0.446 FCK, not 0.67 FCK at that time. But here they have mentioned clearly, consider the factor of safety equal to 1. So in this way, I have calculated the total compressive forces in the terms of depth of neutral axis XU. Now let's calculate the total tensile force. Total tensile force is equal to 0.87 Fy into Ast. So it is equal to 0.87 Fy, the grade of the reinforcement they have given, that is 415. And the reinforcement is 3 bars of 16 mm diameter. 3 into area of 16 mm diameter is 201. So we can calculate the total tensile force equal to 2177 13.15 Newton. Definitely this total compressive force is also in the Newton. So now I can put the total compressive force equal to the total tensile force. So put total compressive force equal to total tensile force. So I can calculate the depth of neutral axis equal to 2177 13.15 divided by 2871.43. So depth of neutral axis will be 76 mm. It is 75.8 something. So I'll be taking 76 mm. So you see your answer for this particular, see your PPT for this particular case. Your depth of neutral axis, option A, B, C, and D, 76 mm, 81 mm, 87 mm, and 100 mm. So answer should be A. Yes, sir. Somebody is asking, sir, this is the variation of strain. Yes, sir, it is the variation of strain across the depth. The maximum compressive strain is 0.0035. Clear? So in this way, I calculated depth of neutral axis for this particular case. Now my next question is, it is a link type question. My next question is, for the same figure, suppose the depth of neutral axis, this is my next question, the depth of the neutral axis obtained as per IS 456-2000 differs from the depth of neutral axis obtained in the question number 2, means this question. In this question, we have calculated 76 mm depth of neutral axis. Now, he is asking, if I don't consider the rectangular portion, I am considering the same parabolic portion. So, what will be my depth of neutral axis and how it differs from this 76 mm? So, let's calculate as per the IS 456-2000. As per IS 456-2000, I will be taking the parabolic portion. Right? I will be taking parabolic portion. And I know the total compressive force is 0.36 FCK. B into XU, already we have calculated for IS 456-2000, and the total tensile force again 0.87 Fy Ast. So total tensile force will be remain same, only that there is a change in the compression, compressive forces. So you have 0.36, the grade of concrete they have given 20, the width they have given 300 mm, and the depth of neutral axis I need to calculate. We have calculated already the total tensile force equal to 0.87 Fy, that is a grade 415. And the ST means 3 bars of 16 mm diameter. The diameter is 16 mm, so area of cross section of one reinforcement is 201. 3 bars are there, that's why I multiplied by 3. So total tensile force I know It is 2177 13.5 Newton. If I calculate this, I get the total compressive force 2160 into depth of neutral axis, Newton. So I can calculate total depth of neutral axis as per the IS 456, putting C equal to T. So the depth of neutral axis is equal to 2177 13.5 divided by 2160. So here I am getting almost 101 mm. So I have calculated the depth of neutral axis as 101. In the previous case, I got the value 76 mm. In this case, I got the value 101. My question is, the difference between these two depth of neutral axis, the variation is 101 minus 76. So the difference is 101 minus 76 mm equal to 25 mm. My answer is 25 mm. That is the option C. Right? So in this way we solve the question. Now let's start. So I think you people have solved, and in this way we calculated the depth of neutral axis considering the limit state assumptions, and this we have calculated as per the given question. So the difference between two depth of neutral axis we got 25 mm, and the option is C. Now let's see the limiting depth of the neutral axis. What is the limiting depth of the neutral axis that we are going to discuss now? The limiting depth of the neutral axis. Limiting depth of the neutral axis. What is the meaning of this? Limiting depth of the neutral axis. See here. You can write the definition. It is the maximum depth of the neutral axis for the balanced condition for which the total compressive force equal to 0.36 FCK V into XU and total tensile force reaches to 0.87 F by AST. If in my beam concrete reaches their maximum value of 0.36 FCK B into XU and the reinforcement if reaches their maximum permissible value of 0.87 F by AST, that means whatever the section you have designed is balanced section, and the depth of neutral axis is called the SU balance or limiting depth of the neutral axis. It is also called the maximum depth of the neutral axis. So there are three names. First is your SU balance. I can denote it as a SU balance because the section will be in the balance condition. The strain is reaching to 0.0035 in the compression, and in the tension the strain is reaching to 0.002 plus 0.87 Fi by ES. So it is called XU balance. It's also called XU max because it is the maximum depth of the neutral axis for the balance condition. It is also called XU limit. So there are three notations for this. We can either represent this XU by XU balance or by XU max or by XU limit. So how to find this XU limit? This we can find easily. How to find? Suppose as per the definition, we people know, suppose this is a variation of the strain in my beam, the maximum compressive strain I know 0.0035 and here it is 0.002 plus 0.87 Fi by ES. This is suppose your depth of neutral axis And I told you, I can give the name SU bias or SU limit or SU max, because the stresses here are reaching to 0.36 FCK B into XU, and the stresses here are reaching to 0.87 FI AST. So that's why it is called balanced section, and the depth of the neutral axis is called limiting depth of the neutral axis. Notation is XU limit. So if it is the total effective depth is D, so if this much is your XU limit, so definitely this distance will be your, the remaining depth will be your D minus XU limit. If I take the property from similar triangular, you can write 0.0035 divided by XU limit is equal to 0.002 plus 0.87 FY by ES divided by D minus XU limit. I know the modulus of elasticity for this steel is 2 into 10 to the power 5 Newton per mm square. So I can write D minus XU limit divided by XU limit. I have shifted this value here and this value here. 0.002 plus 0.87 FY divided by modulus of elasticity, that is 2 into 10 to the power 5 Newton per mm square. If you arrange this value, you will be getting XU limit equal to 700 divided by 1100 plus 0.87 FY into D. If I write XU limit equal to K into D, so definitely the value of K equal to 700 divided by 1100 plus 0.87 FY, where K is called neutral axis constant. K is called neutral axis constant. Please prepare this figure and write down from here and then here. K is called neutral axis constant. So one thing we should notice here, your depth of the neutral axis, the limiting depth of the neutral axis for a particular beam, it depends on the grade of steel only. D is constant for a particular depth, for particular beams, the D is constant. So your XU limit depends on the grade of steel only. It does not depend the grade of concrete. It depends only on the grade of steel. Right? So now let's calculate this limiting depth of the neutral axis for the different grade of steels. So now I know, suppose the grade of steel FY is Fe250, Fe415 and Fe500. Right? So your XU limit equal to K into D. Where K, I know the value of K already we have discussed. The value of K is your 700 divided by 1100 plus 0.87 FY. It's called the neutral axis constant. So can we calculate the limiting depth of the neutral axis in the terms of D? Yes, we can calculate. For Fe250, just put here 250. So 700 divided by 1100 plus 0.87 into 250. So I'll be getting 0.53. So here I can write the limiting depth of the neutral axis 0.53D. Similarly for 0.415, I can write 0.48D. Similarly for 500 grade, I can write 0.46D. With respect to XU limit, if I want to calculate the moment of resistance, MOR, we we generally denote by mu limit. For x, if I am putting x equal to xu limit, I will be getting mu limit. So here, if I am to calculate mu limit, so I can write, I know the moment of resistance equal to the, suppose mu limit equal to, I know formula for moment of resistance. See how I am calculating, let's calculate here. The moment of resistance, suppose, is 0.36 FCKB into XU into D minus 0.42 XU. This already we have calculated. This is the moment of resistance in the compression zone. And suppose, how to calculate this? So what I am going to do, 0.36 FCKB, in the place of XU, I am writing XU limit. XU limit. For the balance section, D minus 0.42, again in the place of XU, I am going to write XU limit for balance condition. Now, my XU limit depends on the grade of steel only. So suppose I want to find, for Fe250, I want to calculate the moment of resistance of my section. If I am providing the reinforcement of grade Fe250, I can calculate the moment of resistance 0.36 FCKB. Here I will be writing 0.53 D, then D minus 0.42, in the place of again XU limit, I will be writing 0.53 D. So in the terms of B, D and FCK, I can calculate the moment of resistance. I will be getting 0.148 FCK BD square. This is the moment of resistance for that particular section where I am going to provide the steel of grade Fe250. This moment of resistance will be called mu limit, the limiting moment of resistance. I can write here the limiting moment of resistance because this will be the moment of resistance for the balance condition because I have used XU limit, the limiting depth of the neutral axis in my beam. So here I can write, in this way I have calculated 0.148 FCK BD square for Fe250. In the similar fashion I can calculate for Fe415 as well as for Fe500. So, if I calculate, I'll be getting here 0.148 FCK BD square. For Fe415, I'll be getting 0.138 FCK BD square. And for Fe500, I will be getting 0.133 FCK BD square. So in this way, I have calculated the limiting depth of the neutral axis for a particular beam. The depth is constant and the moment of resistance in this way. It is the limiting value of moment of resistance for the balance section. Please note down. Now let's solve problem. See your PPT. Get 2002 for 2 marks. Get 2002 for 2 marks. So very simple. Can you give me answer? Yes, answer is D. Because all this value 0.53D, 0.48D and 0.46D we calculated for the different grades of steel. So your answer is D. Because all the values given there depends on the different grade of steels. So answer should be D. Now let's solve the next problem. So recently in this year only they have asked in the GATE 2017 for 1 mark. So GATE 2017 for 1 mark. Which one of the following statement is correct? Please read the question carefully and try to give the answer. As per as 456-2000, which one of the following statement about the depth of neutral axis, XU balance? I told you, generally we denote the limiting depth of neutral axis by XU max or XU balance or XU limited. For a balanced reinforced concrete section is correct. So option they have given A, B, C, D. From here we can see your K does not depend on the grade of concrete. It depends only the grade of steel. So the answer should be B. XU balance depends on the grade of steel only. Right? If you know the grade of steel, easily we can calculate the XU balance. Right? Now let's start. Now we'll see what type of the problems are generally asked in the exams. From the singly reinforced beam, what type of the problems generally asked in the exam? Now we are going to start. See, generally two types of the problems they generally ask in the exam. The type problem number one is type of sections. So see here in the type of sections, suppose this is the beam. And this is suppose the strain variation. It is a linear, right? And here suppose the strain is 0.0035 and here the strain is 0.002 plus 0.87 Fy by ES. So what will happen? This is the depth of the neutral axis suppose. And I know as per the definition of the limiting depth of neutral axis, if the strain is reaching to 0.0035, when the stresses are 0.36 FCKB into FCU, and the strain in the tensile reinforcement is reaching to 0.002 plus 0.87 Fy by ES, means the stresses in the tensile reinforcement equal to 0.87 Fy AST. So it is called Derenz section, and the depth of neutral axis will be definitely equal to FCU limit. Just we have calculated FCU limit, it depends on the grade of steel only. So here, this is the variation of strain. This type of sections are called Bélaise section. So for the Bélaise section, you can write down stresses in concrete sigma c. Stresses in concrete are greater than or equal to sigma c permissible. Stresses in steel are greater than or equal to stresses in steel permissible. Means the stresses in, what is the meaning of this? The stresses in the concrete reaches to their permissible value and the stresses in the steel are reaches to their permissible value together, simultaneously. So definitely, both concrete and steel will fail together. So this type of sections are called Bélaise section because the compressive forces are balanced by the tensile forces, C equal to T. In this case, your depth of neutral axis is equal to actual depth of neutral axis. Actual depth of neutral axis are equal to the FCU limit, the maximum depth of neutral axis. And your bending moment, that is the moment of resistance, is equal to MU limit, the limiting depth, limiting moment of resistance. See, limiting value of bending moment. Now let me draw one more section. Suppose the variation is something like this. The variation of strain is something like this. So what will happen? This will be your depth of neutral axis, XU, right? But this time, this is called under reinforced section. This is called under reinforced section. So you can write down the stresses in concrete is less than sigma c permissible. Stresses in steel are greater than or equal to stresses in steel permissible. You can see here the depth of neutral axis is less than XU limit. Means you can see here it was the XU limit and here is the your XU. Your XU is this much, XU limit is this much and XU is this much. That means your depth of neutral axis shifted up. Your depth of neutral axis is get shifted up. In the case of under reinforced section, where the stresses in the concrete does not reach their permissible value, but the stresses in the steel, they reaches their permissible value. Means, here the steel will fail first. Because the stresses in the steel already reach their permissible value, so steel will fail first. And steel, I know, it is a ductile material, so the failure type is called ductile failure. So I can write here, steel will fail first. concrete will fail. And that failure is called ductile failure. The failure type is your ductile failure, and here we get alarm. Here we get alarm. What is the meaning of alarm here? See, I know my concrete is a brittle material and the steel is a ductile material. The stresses in the concrete does not reach their permissible value. That means your concrete will not fail here. But the stresses in the steel reaches their permissible value. That means your steel is going to fail here. So that means your steel will fail first in the beam and then concrete will fail. So what I need to understand here, if the steel will fail here, the steel is a ductile material, so definitely I'll be observing, I can notice the cracks in the bottom of my beam. So when I'm observing the cracks in the bottom of beam, immediately I can run from the building. I can go out from my building. So it gives the alarm. Your building, your beam will not collapse. It will give me alarm. I can save my life. That's why it gives the alarm, and the failure type is called ductile failure. Then the question is how to achieve this under-reinforced section. So under-reinforced section is achieved by providing limited amount of reinforcement. This under-reinforced section are achieved by providing limited amount of reinforcement. My third type of the section is over-reinforced section. Again, I am drawing the strain variation. You can see here, the depth of neutral axis gets shifted down. The depth of neutral axis gets shifted down. That means, here I can write, over-reinforced section. Over-reinforced section. As the name indicates, over-reinforced means I provide the reinforcement in excessive amount. So this type of sections are achieved by providing excessive amount of reinforcement. So here what happens? Stresses in concrete reaches to their permissible value, but stresses in the steel does not reach their permissible value. The depth of neutral axis, XU, is greater than XU limit. Here concrete will fail first. Then steel will fail. Since concrete is a ductile material, concrete is a brittle material, so that failure type is called brittle failure. No alarm. So you can see here the difference between these three type of sections. Let me start under reinforced section. You can see here in the under reinforced section, we provide limited amount of reinforcement. We people provide the limited amount of reinforcement. So what will happen when the tensile stresses will be more? So definitely your steel will fail first, and the stresses in the steel will reach their permissible value. So the steel will fail first, and my steel is a ductile material. So the failure type is called ductile failure. So when the steel will fail, definitely I can observe the cracks in the bottom of my beam. So I can run immediately from my building and I can go out. So in this way I can get the alarm here in the case of under reinforced section. In this case, your depth of neutral axis gets shifted up in the case of under reinforced section. Let me discuss now the over reinforced section. If I talk about the over reinforced section, as the name indicates, over reinforced means if suppose I have provided the reinforcement in excessive amount. Suppose the requirement is 4 bars of 20 mm diameter, Suppose the requirement is 4 bars of 20 mm diameter and I have provided 8 bars of 20 mm diameter. Means I have provided the reinforcement in excessive amount. This is more than the required. So what will happen? In this case, I have designed the over-reinforced section. So whatever the stresses are coming in the tension, that will be safe. That will be taken by your steel because you have provided the sufficient steel. So this time steel will not fail because you have already provided the sufficient reinforcement. And more than that, actually. But you have provided the less concrete. Right? So what will happen if you provided the less concrete? So the stresses in the concrete will increase and they will reach their permissible value. So when the stresses in the concrete will reach their permissible value, the concrete will fail first. And I know my concrete is a brittle material. So that failure type is called the brittle failure. If the failure is the brittle failure, that means I will not be getting any alarm. Immediately your beam will collapse. Right? So that's why I have written here no alarm. And you can observe here, if there is a failure in the concrete, the depth of the neutral axis gets shifted down. Means your XU is greater than XU limit. Your XU limit is up to here only. And here the XU is this much. So definitely your XU is greater than XU limit. So these are the three sections, balance section, under-reinforced section, and the over-reinforced section we have studied. As a good civil engineer, we always want to design either the balance section or the under-reinforced section. We do not go for the over-reinforced section because it won't give us alarm. It's a brittle failure. Definitely, when the stresses will reach their permissible value, immediately your beam will collapse. So I want either the ductile failure or I want to design the balance section. So in this way, we have discussed the three type of the sections. What type of the problems are generally asked in the gate examinations? Then we will start. Now we are going to start type of problem. Now we are going to start type of problems. So generally, what type of the problems are being asked in the last, in the previous year's questions that we are going to analyze now. So type of problems you can find. The first type of the problem you can find, calculate moment of resistance. So here they will give dimension of the beams, reinforcement of the beam, that means already the one designed beam they will provide you, and they will ask, analyze this beam and find the total moment of resistance. This is the first type of the problem they may ask. So how to solve this type of the problems? So first of all, what we will do, the step first, calculate XU limit. I know the XU limit is equal to K into D, which is actually equal to 0.53D, 0.48D and 0.46D. This is for Fe 250, this is for Fe 415, and this is for Fe 500. Second step, step 2, calculate actual depth of the neutral axis, XU. How to calculate this XU? We can calculate XU by putting C equal to T. Putting C equal to T. I know C equal to 0.36 FCK B into XU equal to 0.87 FMI AST, as per limit state of collapse in fracture. So I can calculate my XU is equal to 0.87 FMI AST divided by 0.36 FCK B. So this is my second step. Now in the third step, step 3, you should compare this XU and XU limit. Compare XU and XU limit. We know if XU is exactly equal to the XU limit, it is called balanced section. It is called balanced section. So we'll be use XU limit. We'll be using XU limit for further calculation. If XU is less than XU limit, that means it is called under reinforced section. URS means under reinforced section. So here I will be using actual value of XU, actual value, that is XU. Whatever the XU you have calculated using C equal to T, from here you will be able to calculate the depth of neutral axis XU. Whatever the XU you are calculating here, the same value of XU will be using for the further calculations. If your XU is greater than XU limit, it is called over-reinforced section. ORS means over-reinforced section. So in this over-reinforced section, we'll be use the value of XU limit for further calculation. Here we'll be using whatever the value we are getting, XU limit. Here we'll be using the whatever the actual value of the depth of neutral axis we are getting. And here we'll be using the XU limit. We know in for the over-reinforced section, the depth of neutral axis get shift down. So here XU limit will be taking for an over-reinforced section. Because we do not want to design the over-reinforced section, that's why we want to limit our depth of neutral axis up to the maximum value, that is the XU limit only. That's why I have taken XU limit in the case of over-reinforced section. I do not want to design the over-reinforced section. In the case, if I am getting this condition X where XU is greater than XU limit, I will be taking the maximum depth of the neutral axis equal to XU limit. I will not be using the actual value. Now step 4, the question is, they will ask, calculate the moment of resistance. So calculate the moment of resistance. In this step 4, we will be able to calculate the moment of resistance. We know the formula for moment of resistance. That is, suppose in the compression zone I want to calculate, it will be your 0.36. I can write moment of resistance in the compression zone equal to 0.36. FCK B into XU into D minus 0.42 XU. This formula already we have discussed and we have derived also. So here you can see, suppose you are getting balance section. So in the place of XU here and here, you can write XU limit. If suppose I am getting under reinforced section, so at the place of XU and XU, I will be taking the value, whatever the actual value of XU I am getting. In the case of over reinforced section, here and here, I'll be putting the XU limit. This is the formula in the compression zone. I can apply the formula in the tension zone also. That is equal to 0.87 FY AST D minus 0.42 XU. So in this way, this is the procedure how to calculate the moment of resistance. This all we have discussed. In this way, I'll be calculating my moment of resistance in the given section. So this is the problem type 1, please note down. Now type of the problem 2, calculate area of reinforcement. Calculate the area of reinforcement, this is the problem type 2. How to calculate this area of reinforcement? So what we need to do here, we already calculated the moment of resistance. After this, what we will do? Suppose you want to calculate the area of reinforcement, two or three formulas are there. The first formula, you can see here, from here also we can calculate the area of AST. If the given bending moment, now I will be treating MOR as a bending moment if I want to calculate AST. Same formula I am going to write here. So step 1, the bending moment is given. So you can assume, if you suppose bending moment they have given, however, the bending moment is given, what we can do in the step 1, we can put the given bending moment equal to moment of resistance. I know moment of resistance is equal to 0.87 FY AST to D minus 0.42 XU. What I am going to do here, put XU equal to XU limit equal to KD. K is the neutral axis constant, the value for the different gate already we have seen. So now we can calculate the area of reinforcement AST equal to whatever the MU they have given. Suppose MU they have given in the kilo newton meter, so I need to multiply here 10 to the power 6 to get it into the newton mm. Now You can see here, I can write 0.87 f of I d minus 0.42 xu limit. D minus 0.42 xu limit. So this is the formula. This is the one formula to calculate area of reinforcement required to resist the bending moment mu, where mu is given in kilonewton meter and the AST is calculated in mm square. Whatever the AST you will be getting from here, it will be in the mm square, and the mu is in the kilonewton meter you will be putting here, and you will be multiplying by 10 to the power 6. This is the one formula. This is your one formula. Using the formula, you can calculate. One more formula is there. We can calculate using that also. AST equal to 0.5 FCK divided by FY into 1 minus under root 1 minus 4.6 MU into 10 to the power 6 divided by FCK BD square into B into D. This is the one more formula using which you can calculate the area of reinforcement. One more formula is there. I know C equal to T. I know C equal to T. The total C is equal to 0.36 FCK B into XU. Here I will be taking XU limit equal to T equal to 0.87 FY AST. For the balance condition, I take total compressive forces equal to the total tensile forces. So from here, I will be able to calculate the total AST required to satisfy this C equal to T, and AST equal to 0.36 FCK B into XU limit divided by 0.87 FY. This is your one more formula to calculate area of reinforcement. Formula number 3. Using any formula, you can calculate the area of reinforcement. All the formula will give the same answer in the mm square. Here also, mu I have multiplied by 10 to the power 6 because mu I have taken in kilonewton meter and all other parameters are in newton and mm. So this AST will be calculated in the terms of in the unit of mm square. One condition we should note here. Please note down, then we will see what is the condition. These all three formulas are AST required. You can write down this is AST required. This is also AST required. This is also AST required. So, these all the formulas are for AST required. Means the requirement of reinforcement either to satisfy this condition C equal to T or to take this bending moment, to resist this bending moment MU. This area of reinforcement is required. Using any formula we can calculate and we'll be getting the same results. So now let me define what is the condition. If you want to design the balanced beam or under reinforced beam, what we need to do here, in any case, your AST required shall not be less than AST minimum. The condition is, in any case, your AST required shall not be less than AST minimum. So what is the value of AST minimum here? So I am going to write the value of AST minimum. The AST minimum required in the beam is equal to AST minimum divided by BD shall be greater than or equal to 0.85 divided by FY. So from here, B, if the cross-section dimension of the given section are known and the grade of steel we know, so easily we can calculate the area of reinforcement required. The minimum area of reinforcement required, then we can calculate from this formula, minimum area of reinforcement. This is your first condition. Condition number first. The second condition is, in any case, your AST required shall not be greater than AST maximum. In any case, AST required shall not be greater than AST maximum. And what is the value of AST maximum that I am going to write here? The AST maximum is equal to, the AST maximum is equal to 4% of gross area. Or we can write the 4% of total cross-sectional area. Total cross-sectional area. So here we can write 0.04 into B into D. So this is, in this way we can calculate if the B and D, the gross dimension, width and the depth are known, then easily we can calculate the total AST maximum. We are not going to provide the reinforcement greater than or more than AST maximum. If the AST maximum is 2000 mm square, we are not going to provide the reinforcement more than 2000 mm square. We provide the reinforcement less than that, AST maximum. So, in this way we calculate AST maximum. Now somebody should ask me, why we are going to provide the AST greater than the AST minimum and why we are going to provide AST required less than AST maximum. What we are doing, we are going to provide the reinforcement in the beam greater than or more than AST minimum. And we are going to provide the reinforcement less than AST maximum. So my answer, our first question is the AST minimum is provided in the beam for the sufficient ductility. The minimum reinforcement area we have provided in the beam for the sufficient ductility in the beam, and the AST maximum, the, we have limited the area of reinforcement. We are not going to provide the more reinforcement greater than AST maximum because there will be the problem of congestion. If the more number of reinforcement if you have provided, so in that case you cannot compact your concrete. If you cannot compact your concrete, there will be pores in the concrete, definitely the strength of the beam will decrease. So in that situation, what I need to do here, I need to provide one limit in reinforcement, and that is nothing but your AST maximum, and that is the 4% of the total cross-sectional area. And the AST minimum we have provided for the ductility in the beam. We want the ductility in the beam because we do not want the brittle failure. We want the ductile failure. That's why the minimum reinforcement is provided to get the sufficient ductility in the beam. So in this way we calculate the area of reinforcement. This is the problem type 2. Now let's solve the problems. For the single reinforcement, please see your PPT. Get 2014 for 2 marks. The question is, for a given beam, the cross section they have given, the cross section is 230 mm. By 500 mm. Means they have given the B equal to 230 and the effective depth equal to 500. The number of reinforcement they have provided of 12 mm diameter. And you're asking the number of reinforcement of 12 mm diameter to satisfy the minimum tension reinforcement. I know the formula of AST minimum BD is equal to 0.85 divided by FY. So AST minimum, I can calculate 0.85 divided by FY. The grade of steel is given 500. Fe 500 we are going to use in this beam. So B they have given 230 and the effective depth they have given 500. So the AST minimum we can calculate, it is equal to 195.5 mm square. Now we are going to provide the number of bars equal to the total AST divided by AST of one bar. We are going to provide 12 mm diameter bar, so 195.5 divided by diameter of 12 mm bar is 113. How I have calculated 113? It is equal to pi by 4 into 12 square. So it will give me the diameter bar of tail end and diameter. So 113, here I can get 1.73. Means I am going to provide 2 reinforcement in my beam. I cannot provide 1.73. In whatever the reinforcement I am getting here, I am going to provide more than that. So of course I will be providing 2 reinforcement. I will not provide the 1 reinforcement. I will be providing 2 reinforcement, 2 bars of 12 mm diameter in the given section. So in this way I have calculated the given bars. It was for GATE 2014 for 2 marks. Let's solve one more problem. The CE or PPT. Get question CE 2016 for 2 marks CATE 1. It's a very simple question. I think the problem type 1. In the problem type 1, we have discussed how to calculate the moment of resistance. We have written the 4 steps. Calculate the moment of resistance for the given section. So they have given me, you can see here, they have given me B equal to 200 mm, D equal to 300 mm, effective depth is equal to 300 mm they have given, total AST they have given, 4 bars of 12 mm diameter, 113 is the area of 12 mm diameter, FY they have given me, FE 415. FCK they have given 25, M25 means 25 Newton per mm square. Here also FE 415 means 415 Newton per mm square. And they have asked calculate the moment of resistance for the given section. How we calculate? Let's calculate. We know the step number first. The step number first, calculate XU limit. For FE 415, we know it is 0.48D. So 0.48 into D is known, that is 300 mm. So it will be your 144 mm. And step number 2, calculate XU. We know how to calculate XU. We put C equal to T. We put the total compressive forces are equal to the total tensile forces. So from here we are calculating total depth of neutral axis, that is 0.87 FY AST divided by 0.36 FCK B. So 0.87 FY is 415, AST is the 4 bars of 12 mm diameter divided by 0.36 FCK they have given 25, width they have given 200 mm, right? So the depth of neutral axis I am getting here, you can calculate here. I am getting the depth of neutral axis is 90.667 mm. Right? Now, the third step, step 3. We need to compare the XU and XU limit. Compare XU and XU limit. XU limit is your 144 and your XU is 90.66. So definitely, it is your under reinforced section. For the given section, X is less than XU limit, so it is your under-reinforced section. And already mentioned, if it is the under-reinforced section, we'll be using the actual depth of the neutral axis in calculation of moment of resistance. So let me calculate the step number 4. In the step number 4, I will be calculating my moment of resistance. So my moment of resistance for the given section, I can calculate, that is equal to, you can calculate in the compression zone, you can calculate in the tension zone. In the both zones, you'll be getting the same moment of resistance. So you have 0.36, FCK they have given 25. Width is 200 mm. The DFT already we have calculated 90.667 into D is 300 mm, 0.42 XU. Let's calculate. This will give answer in Newton mm. But we want the answer in kilonewton meter. We want the answer in kilonewton meter. So what I will do, whatever answer I will be getting from this equation, I will multiply it into 10 to the power minus 6. Into 10 to the power minus 6. So my moment of resistance is 42.747 kilo Newton meter. So in this way, I have calculated the moment of resistance in kilo Newton meter, and this is the answer for my question. Somebody has calculated 62.808. It is wrong. Actually, this is the correct answer, 42.747. You can find the same moment of resistance in the tension zone also. It will give the same value. If you want to calculate in the tension zone, your moment of resistance will be 42.67. It is also correct. Fine, 42.67. One student got the 42.67. It is also correct. You can calculate in the tension zone also the moment of resistance. In the tension zone, we can calculate. That is 0.87 FYST into D minus 0.42 XU. 0.87 FY is 415. AST, they have provided the 4 bars of 12 mm diameter into these 300 mm minus 0.42 into XU. Already we have calculated, that is 90.667. So the moment of resistance will be same 42.747 kilonewton meter. So in this way, I calculate the moment of resistance for the given sections. Now let's solve one more problem. Get 1999 for 1 mark. So very simple problem. We already people have discussed. Can you give me your answer? Please read the question carefully. It is for 1 mark. What is answer? Of course, answer A. Because we know the minimum, AST minimum formula, we know it is your AST minimum divided by B is equal to 0.85 divided by FY. So definitely your AST minimum will be 0.85 BD divided by FY. So in this way, I can calculate the AST minimum. So your answer is A. Let's calculate. Let's solve one more problem. Please read the question. It is asked in the GATE 2007. Very easy question. Asked in the GATE 2007. Whenever you solve any problems, please write down. First, you should start with the given data. Then it will help you to solve the problem. Given data. See here what they have given. Width they have given 150 mm. Effective depth they have given 330 mm. FCK they have given 20 Newton per mm square. Means M20 grade of concrete we are going to use here. Tensile strength of the steel they have given 415 Newton per mm square. Means every 415 grade we are going to use here. And he has suggested adopt the stress block given by IS 456-2000 and find it is given here. The limiting value of moment of resistance of the beam in kilonewton meter. This is the first question. The continued of the this question. Read this question. With this data, we need to find the limiting value of moment of resistance of the beam in kilonewton meter. Can we calculate? Yes, we can calculate. The limiting value. Already we have seen the limiting value. MU limit. So how to calculate the MU limit? I know the direct formula for MU limit, or we can derive the MU limit. What is the formula for MU limit? 0.36 FCK B into XU D minus 0.42 XU. But he has asked the limiting value of the bending moment, means the limiting value of moment, means I am going to put XU equal to XU limit. I am going to put the XU is equal to XU limit here at this position and at this position. So what I need to do here, and I know the grade he has used is Fe415, so definitely your XU limit will be equal to 0.48D. The D value I know, it is 0.48 into D is your 330. If I put the 0.48D here, so I will be getting the formula, already we have derived, 0.138 FCK BD square. This formula we have discussed, already we have derived. So we can calculate 0.138. FCK is, they have given 20. Width they have given 150. And 330 is square. So we can calculate the moment of resistance here. And I am getting the value 45.08 kilonewton meter. The answer is C. Answer for this particular question is C. The moment of resistance I will be getting here 45.08 kilonewton meter. Because I put here X limit is equal to 0.48 T. It's called the limiting moment of resistance. Option answer is C. That is 45.08 kilonewton meter. One more question is there. It is a link type question. With this problem, he has asked, calculate the limiting area of tensile steel in mm square. Can we calculate the limiting area of tension reinforcement? Yes, we can calculate the limiting area of tension reinforcement. We know the three formula. Already we have discussed the three formula to calculate ASD. Formula is known to me. That is ASD equal to 0.5 FCK divided by FY into 1 minus under root 1 minus 4.6 MU limit into 10 to the power 6 divided by FCK BD square into BD. So one thing you people should notice here, I want to calculate AST limiting value of AST limit. So what I did, I put here MU limit. If I want to calculate AST limit, I will be putting here MU limit. And just now we have calculated the value of MU limit. So we can calculate 0.5, FCK is 20, F1 is 415 into 1 minus under root 1 minus 4.6, 45.08 into 10 to the power 6 divided by FCK is 20, B is here 150 into 330 square into BD. BD is your 150 into 330. So we can calculate AST limiting value of AST. So answer is, with this calculation, you will be getting 471.8 mm square. So the answer should be A. Answer is A. The closest answer is A, 473.9 mm square is your answer. Answer A for this particular question. One student asked the question, what is the difference between the minimum reinforcement, minimum area of reinforcement and the limiting area of reinforcement? So I want to tell you, the limiting area of reinforcement means we need to provide the limiting area of reinforcement to take the MU limit, means the limiting moment of resistance. Suppose the MU limit, I got 45.08 kilonewton meter in this question, right? So in this case, if the bending moment is coming 45.08 kilonewton meter, I should provide AST of 479.8 mm square. So this is called the limiting area to take the limiting moment of resistance. But the AST minimum means we need to provide AST minimum to get the enough ductility in the beam. For the minimum ductility, we provide the AST minimum. So let's check your this AST, you have calculated AST limited is greater than AST minimum or not. We can calculate. Very good question, yes asked. So in any case, I will not provide the reinforcement less than AST minimum. So see, AST minimum divided by BD is equal to 0.85 by FY. So I can calculate 0.85 divided by 415 into BD. B is 150 and D is 330. So let's calculate the value of AST minimum. It is 101.35. 0.39 mm square. So see, in any case, I am not going to provide the area of reinforcement less than this. So see here, I have provided 473 mm square. And the minimum required is 101. Means, I have designed safe beam. My beam is safe. Right? So this is the difference between the AST minimum and the AST limiting value. Now we are going to start. Till now, we have discussed the singly reinforced beam. Now we are going to start doubly reinforced beam. Very interesting topic, doubly reinforced beam. In the doubly reinforced beam, we provide the reinforcement in the top also. So see here, suppose this is the one beam. Let me prepare one bigger size. Suppose 5 reinforcement I have provided and 2 reinforcement in the top I have provided. Suppose 3 I have provided in the top. This is a doubly reinforced beam. The doubly singly reinforced beam means we provide the reinforcement in the bottom of the beam only. But to rest, in this case, we provide the reinforcement in the top also to restrict the depth. If in any case, then you should ask me why, when we should provide the doubly reinforced beam. See, just we have calculated one moment of resistance value. Moment of resistance we just calculated, that is 45.08 kilonewton meter. Right? We just calculated. In any case, for that particular section, if the applied bending moment is 55.08 kilonewton meter, I have designed one beam which can take the bending moment of, means the moment of resistance is 45.08 kilonewton meter. But on the same beam, suppose the load is coming 55, means it is the resistance and it is the applied load. So what I need to do here, I need to resist the additional 10 kilonewton meter load. This is your MU limit, right? We have calculated the MU limit. So what I need to do here, I will provide some area of reinforcement, that is AST2, in the bottom of my beam. And this AST2 I will be providing for MU minus MU limit. 55.08 minus 48.08 means for 10 kilonewton meter, this is an additional bending moment which I want to resist. So I will be providing additional bending moment. So I will be providing additional reinforcement in the top bottom of my beam. So I have provided additional reinforcement in the bottom of my beam means I have increased the total tensile forces. Right? So I need, but I want the balance section, I want C equal to T. If I want C equal to T, what I need to do here? I need to provide the compressive forces also, because by providing additional reinforcement in the bottom of beam, I have increased the total tensile forces. But the compressive forces are same. I'm not going to provide the extra concrete now. So what I will do, if I want to restrict my depth of the beam, I will provide additional reinforcement in the top of the beam above the neutral axis, which will be taking the compressive forces. So in this way, I increase the compressive forces also and I satisfy the condition C equal to T. Right? So what I am going to do here, please try to understand. This is your total AST and this is total ASC. This total AST means AST1 and AST2. And AC means area of reinforcement in the compression zone. I am going to divide this figure into two parts. This is your figure 1, where I have provided, suppose, 3 reinforcement. This is your AST1. This is your AST1. And the remaining portion will be your to resist that additional moment, I have provided 2 more reinforcement, suppose AST2. So in this way, I have increased the total tensile forces. And this way, I have increased the total tensile forces. So what I need to do here, I need to increase the total compressive forces also. So I have provided AC, area of reinforcement in the compression zone, to satisfy C equal to T. Here there is a no concrete. This dotted line is showing there is no concrete, but there is a concrete. If I add these two figure, definitely I will be getting this main figure. Right? So one thing I can tell you here, this portion, this figure one, this figure number one, and this is your figure number two. So here this figure number one is acting as a balanced singly reinforced beam. And AST1 is nothing but AST limiting. So here I can write, this is your singly reinforced beam. The figure 1 I can analyze as a singly reinforced beam for a balanced condition. This beam in the balanced condition. That means this beam can resist MU limit. This beam can resist the moment equal to MU limit. The moment of resistance is MU limit. And the depth of the neutral axis is equal to XU limit. Area of steel is nothing but AST limit. AST1 equal to AST limit. I know how to calculate AST limit. I have one formula. In the place of MU, I will be writing MU limit. And MU limit, I know how to calculate. For different grades of steel, I know 0.13, 0.148 FCK BD square for Fe250, 0.138 FCK BD square for Fe415, 0.133 FCK BD square for Fe500. So I can calculate MU limit. I know how to calculate XU limit. That is also known to me. 0.53D for Fe250, 0.48D for Fe415, and 0.46 for Fe500. Then I'll be calculating AST. So I have analyzed one first figure. How to analyze this second? This AST2 means, why I have provided AST2? To resist additional bending moment. Suppose the additional bending moment is MU. Total bending moment is suppose MU. So additional will be MU minus MU limit. Suppose, for example, MU is coming 100 kN meter, and your this figure, this singly reinforced beam can resist 80 kN meter. So now we need to provide the reinforcement for 20 kN meter. Because after this 100 kN meter, 80 kN meter we already resisted by providing singly reinforced beam. Now we need to resist only additional 20 kN meter load, 20 kN meter moment. So for this particular moment, I am going to provide AST2 in the bottom of my beam. So suppose I have provided AST2 for the bending moment, MU minus MU limit. Right? I know the formula. AST. Here you can see the lever arm is same, D minus 0.42 XU. The lever arm is D minus 0.42 XU limit. That is the difference between the total compressive force and the total tensile force. The distance between the total compressive force and the total tensile force is called the lever arm. This I know here in the case of singly reinforced beam. But here where I have provided the additional reinforcement, in this case, what is the lever arm? So definitely, the total tensile force will be acting here. Definitely the total tensile force are acting here at the CG of my reinforcement. The total tensile force and the total compressive force are acting here at the CG of top reinforcement, the compression reinforcement. This is called compression reinforcement. So the distance between two, suppose I have provided the compression reinforcement at the distance of D'. I have provided the compression reinforcement at the distance of D' from the tough fiber. So total lever arm for this particular case will be, the total distance is your effective depth is D. So the lever arm will be D minus D'. This will be lever arm, right? So here we can find AST2. AST2 we can calculate. How to calculate AST2? AST2 equal to MU minus MU limit divided by 0.87 F by D minus D dash. If you multiply 0.87 Fy into ST2 is the total tensile force into D minus D dash is the lever arm, mean this is the bending moment, right? It is the moment of resistance and equal to mu minus mu limit. So in this way we can calculate ST2. Here mu minus mu limit I know. Mu limit I am calculating from here. Mu is given to me. 0.87 Fy is the grade of steel I know. D, effective depth of the beam I know. D dash, that is the effective cover for the top reinforcement, for the compression reinforcement. That also I know, we can provide 40 to 50 mm generally. So, in this way I can calculate AST2. AST1 already I have calculated, that is the AST limit. Right, so in this way we have calculated AST2 also. Now, I want to calculate AC. AST1 I have calculated, IST2 I have calculated. How to calculate AC? How to calculate AC? So, AC I am going to provide. That now we will discuss how to calculate AC. Before that, we will see now the analysis, how to calculate the moment of total moment of resistance. One moment of resistance due to this, and the second moment of resistance due to this. Now we are going to start the analysis of doubly reinforced beam. So this is the theory, how I proceed for the doubly reinforced beam. This is singly, I divide the total doubly reinforced beam into singly reinforced beam plus the additional reinforcements, top and the bottom. Right? Please note down. See, one figure was there already. It was here ST1, right? And is here figure number 1. It is analyzed as a singly reinforced beam. So, let's calculate the total compressive force in the doubly reinforced beam. For your total compressive force, C equal to, first due to this, 0.36 FCK B into XU plus, this is your first, due to the first singly reinforced beam, this is the compressive force. And you have provided, see here you have provided 3 reinforcement. In this beam, you have provided 3 reinforcement. So, I need to deduct the area of concrete. Right, so suppose at that level the stress is FC, F of SC, the stress in my concrete is suppose 0.446 FCK and the area of is A of SC, right, this is the total compressive force I need to deduct, total compressive force due to this beam is this much. I have provided the 3 reinforcement here, so I need to reduce the area of concrete. Due to the reduction in the area of concrete, there will be reduction in the compressive forces. So that this is the stress, 0.446 FCK, and this is the total area of concrete at that particular location. This is nothing but equal to the area of steel, plus this area of compression reinforcement will also give the compressive forces. So total compression force will be F of SC into AC, where F of SC is the stress in the compression reinforcement. So your compressive force will be 0.36 FCK B into XU, plus A of SC into F of SC minus 0.446 FCK. This is the total compressive force in the beam. These things is due to the singly reinforced beam. This force will be applied by the singly reinforced beam, and the remaining will be applied by your additional reinforcement which you have provided in the top. This is due to the compression reinforcement, and this is due to the singly reinforced beam. So total force will be sum of these two forces. This is the total compressive force. AC is the area of steel in the compression zone, 0.446 FCK we know. What is F of SC? F of SC is the stress in the compression reinforcement. Stress in the tension reinforcement I know, 0.87 Fy, suggested by IS 456 2000. 0.87 Fy is the stress in the tension reinforcement. What is the value of F of SC in the compression reinforcement? Stress in the compression reinforcement is F of SC. How to calculate it? So this is the total compressive force. Now you will see how to calculate F of SC. So I want to calculate F of SC. I know the strain distribution This is the strain of 0.0035. Suppose I have provided, this is the distance d dash. At this level, we have provided the reinforcement AC, and I am assuming the strain in the reinforcement, the strain in the concrete at this reinforcement level is epsilon SC. Epsilon SC is the strain in the concrete at the level of compression reinforcement. So, suppose this is your zero, level of 0.002. This is the total depth of neutral axis XCU. So, on the similar triangular property, I can calculate 0.0035, which is your this distance, divided by depth of neutral axis XCU, equal to. Now, epsilon SC divided by XU minus D dash. Total is XU, this one is D dash. So, this distance will be XU minus D dash. So, from here, I can calculate epsilon SC equal to 0.0035 into 1 minus D dash by XU. 1 minus D dash by XU. This is the strain. This is the strain in the compression reinforcement. This is strain in the concrete at the level of compression reinforcement. So, what I am going to do now, if I calculate the strain, I can calculate the stresses also. I can use SP steel. In the SP steel, they have given the stresses in the steel at the different values of strains. For the different value of strains, we can calculate the stress. We have a stress strain curve for the steel. The values directly you can take from the SP steel. So what I have seen here, suppose I want to calculate the F of SC for Fe400, Fe415. Suppose this is the curve for Fe415. Strain I have calculated. This is the stress strain curve. Strain I have calculated. Suppose the strain is somewhere here. So directly we can calculate the stress value. So this will give me F of SC. In this fashion, we can calculate. In SP16, they have prepared one table for different values of strains. We can directly take from SP16. But if we talk about Fe250, if I talk about Fe250, so what will happen? The Fe250, the stress strain curve suggested by AS code for Fe250 grade of steel, that is the mild steel, is something like this. So what I'm going to do here, this is suppose 0.87 Fi, the value is suppose 0.87 Fi, the stress value is suppose 0.87 Fi. So for different values of strains, for different values of strain, everywhere I am getting the same value of stress. Everywhere the stress is constant, 0.87 Fi. So if you are going to provide, what I mean to say here, if you are going to provide the compression reinforcement of grade Fe250, you can directly take the value of F of SC. You can directly take the value of F of SC equal to 0.87 Fi. If you are providing the grade of steel in the compression zone as a Fe250, directly you can take the stresses in the compression reinforcement equal to 0.87 Fi. That is nothing equal to 0.87 into 250. But if you are going to provide the mild steel, the mild reinforcement, if you are going to provide HYSD bars, that's Fe415 and Fe500 in the compression reinforcement, in that case, you need to use SP16. You need to follow the stress strain curve for the different values of strain. For different values of strain, we can take the value of stresses from the stress strain curve of HYSD bars given in the SP16. So, but for Fe250, we can directly take 0.87 Fi. Total compressive force we have calculated. So, till now, we have seen the total compressive forces, which is nothing but equal to, again, I am going to write 0.36 FCK B into XCU plus A of SC into F of SC minus 0.446 FCK. We have seen this first term is the compressive force due to the singly reinforced beam, plus this compressive force is given by the additional reinforcement which we have provided in the compression zone ASC. So the total compressive force is the summation of these two terms. Now let me calculate the moment of resistance of the doubly reinforced beam. So what I am going to do here, the moment of resistance in the compression zone I can calculate See, for the singly reinforced beam, the lever arm is, we know the lever arm, it is D minus 0.42 XU. So here I can write 0.36 FCK D into XU. This is the total compressive force, and the lever arm is D minus 0.42 XU. Right? Plus, this for the figure 1. This push, this much, this term is for figure 1. Plus, for figure 2, the lever arm, we know D minus D dash. So for figure 2, the total compressive force we have calculated A of SC into F of SC minus 0.446 FCK into lever arm, that is nothing here, D minus D dash. Right? So this is the total moment of resistance applied by second figure. So in this way, I find the moment of resistance in the doubly reinforced beam. Now this total moment of resistance is equal to mu. Now what I mean to say, I have taken one example. When I started the doubly reinforced beam, I told you mu is suppose 100 kilonewton meter, right? And suppose mu limit is suppose 80 kilonewton meter, right? So what I'm going to do here, this is nothing but the moment of resistance is 80 kilonewton meter, and this additional is nothing but your 20 kilonewton meter. So in this way, I have provided the sufficient moment of resistance against my applied bending moment. I have provided the sufficient moment of resistance in my beam by providing the reinforcement in the compression zone AC equal to the bending moment. So now your beam is safe. So these things we have studied in the compression zone. We have calculated the total compressive force as C due to the singly reinforced beam plus area of reinforcement provided in the top of the beam, AC. We have calculated the total moment of resistance applied by singly reinforced beam, the total moment of resistance applied by A of AC, the area of reinforcement in the compression zone. Now, we need to calculate the total tensile force in the tension zone, and we need to calculate total moment of resistance in the tension zone. And definitely, that moment of resistance in the tension zone will be equal to the moment of resistance in the compression zone. So, let me find the total tensile force and the total moment of resistance in the tension zone. Please note down. Right? So, now we are going to discuss total tensile force. So, total tensile force due to this is equal to 0.87 Fy St1, right? This is the total tensile force applied by the singly reinforced beam. Plus, we have provided the additional reinforcement in the bottom also, AST2. And total AST is equal to AST1 plus AST2. So, here 0.87 Fy into AST2. This is the total tensile force in the beam. Will be taken by steel only. As per our assumption of limited state of collapse in flexure, all the tensile stresses will be taken by steel only. So I can calculate the moment of resistance here in the tension zone for this AST1. In this case, the lever arm is known D minus 0.42 SU. So I can calculate 0.87 Fy AST1 into lever arm is D minus 0.42 SU. Fine. Plus, for this case, lever arm is D minus D dash. So 0.87 Fy AST2 into the lever arm is D minus 0.42, sorry, D minus D dash. In this case, the lever arm is D minus D dash. So the lever arm is D minus D dash. So this is the total moment of resistance we have calculated for the doubly reinforced beam in the tension zone. Right? Now the question comes, how to calculate AST1, how to calculate AST2, how to calculate ASC. Total compressive forces, till now we have discussed how to calculate the total compressive forces, we have discussed how to calculate the total tensile forces, we have discussed how to calculate the moment of resistance in the compression zone and the moment of resistance in the tension zone, that we have seen here. Now we will see how to calculate AST1, AST2 and ASC. Please note down this, then we will see the calculation for reinforcement. Good. So we have seen how to calculate the tension force and the compression force as well as the moment of resistance. Now we will see how to calculate ST1. ST1 we are going to provide to resist MU limit. Right? We are going to provide ST1 to resist MU limit. So I know the formula for ST1. ST1 is nothing here, 0.5 FCK divided by FY into 1 minus under root 1 minus 4.6, that is MU limit, into 10 to the power 6 divided by FCK B D square into BD. Where MU limit is in kilonewton meter, then only we will multiply by 10 to the power 6. This is your one formula to calculate AST1. Now, how to calculate AST2? So, AST2 I have provided to resist additional bending moment. Suppose here MU is 100 kN meter, MU limit is 80 kN meter. So, additional bending moment I need to resist is 20 kN meter. To resist this 20 kN meter, I am going to provide AST2. To resist this additional bending moment, I am going to provide an AST2 in the top, in the bottom of my beam, and AC in the in the top of my beam. Right. So AST2, for this AST2, the lever arm is D minus D dash. For this AST2, the lever arm is D minus D dash. So here I can calculate, suppose additional bending moment is MU minus MU limit. Definitely it is the additional bending moment which I am going to resist. The value of this is equal to, bending moment is what? Force into perpendicular distance, force into the lever arm. The force is 0.87 Fy AST2 into D minus D dash is the lever arm. This is the equation. So from here I can calculate AST2 equal to MU minus MU limit divided by 0.87 Fy D minus D dash. So this is the formula for AST2, and this is the formula for ST1. ST1 we have calculated, we know how to calculate ST1, we know how to calculate ST2 now. Now let's calculate AC, area of compression reinforcement. How to calculate area of compression reinforcement? So I provide the compression reinforcement to take the additional bending moment. So there may be two formula to calculate AC. This AC I can calculate using the same concept. Using the same concept we can use this AC, I can resist. And the formula may be your MU minus MU limit. Okay, you write down this. Here I will write. Formula for AC we can write. AC is provided to take the compressive forces. So MU minus MU limit is equal to total compressive forces ASC into F of SC minus 0.446 FCK. This is the total compressive force into the lever arm is D minus D dash. Same way, as we have calculated for ST2. As we have calculated for ST2, same way, in same fashion, we can calculate for ASC. This is your total tensile force resisted by ST2, and this is the lever arm. Same, this is the total compressive force taken by AC, and this is the lever arm. So from here we can calculate area of compression reinforcement, which is nothing but equal to AC equal to MU minus MU limit divided by F of AC minus 0.446 FCK into the lever arm of D minus D dash. This is your one formula using which we can calculate. This is our one formula to calculate AC, area of compression reinforcement. One more formula is there. See, we have provided ST2 in the bottom of the beam. That means we have increased the total tensile forces. Since we have provided the additional reinforcement in the bottom, that is the AST2. In the single reinforced, we have provided ST1. That is fine. It is the balance section. But when you provided AST2, the total tensile forces has been increased. So to satisfy the condition of C equal to T, we need to take the total compressive forces also. We need to increase the total compressive forces by providing the area of reinforcement in the compression zone, that is ASC. So we can put here C equal to T and we can calculate ASC. So let's put Let's put C equal to T in the figure 2. In the figure 2, if I put C equal to T, the total C is due to the area of compression reinforcement is F of SC minus 0.446 FCK. This is the total stress into AC. This is the total compressive force is equal to tensile force. Tensile force given by ST2 is 0.87 FY ST2. So if we calculate ST2, we have seen how to calculate ST2. If the ST2 is known, we can calculate AC. So the formula of AC, we can write one more formula for AC, that is 0.87 FY ST2 divided by F of SC minus 0.446 FCK. This is the formula number 2 to calculate. This is the formula number 2 to calculate area of compression reinforcement. So now you have calculated AST1, you have calculated AST2, you have calculated AC using two formula. Any one formula we can use, Now using this formula, now we know total AST is equal to AST1 plus AST2. So AST1 and AST2 we know, we have calculated. So this much amount of reinforcement we can provide in the bottom of the beam, and this AC we can provide in the top of the beam. In this way, we provide a doubly reinforced beam. In this way, we prepare our doubly reinforced beam. One question is there. Somebody is asking, in the SP16, F of SC will increase or decrease as compared to 0.87 FI. So let me define, sir. Actually, F of SC depends upon the strain. It's the same value for the same curve we are going to use, which are we were using for tensile stress. Same curve we are going to use for the stress strain curve to get the F of SC. It depends on the strain, sir. Whatever the strain, epsilon SC, 0.00351 minus details by SC, we will calculate for the doubly reinforced beam. Using that strain, we can easily find F of SC. So it depends on the strain level. At what strain you want to measure your stress? Because anywhere first the strain will come, then the stress will come. So definitely F of SC depends on the strain. Let's solve one problem. Get 2010. We have 15 minutes. Let's solve one problem. Get 2010 for 2 marks. Please read the question and write down the given data. So the given data is the beam they have given of 300 mm. Effective depth has been given of 500 mm. AST equal to AST1 plus AST2, the total area of tensile reinforcement they have given equal to 2200 mm square. The area of compression reinforcement A of SC they have given 628 mm square. D dash, that is the effective cover for the compression reinforcement, they have given 50 mm. Assume that both the tension and the compression is still yield. Means the strength, the stresses in the both the steels are same. And here we are going to use Fe 250 grade. That means F of SC is equal to 0.87 FI. No need, we do not need to use your stress strain curve. We can directly take F of SC equal to 0.87 FI for the grade Fe 250. So here we can write F of SC is equal to 0.87 FI. This is equal to 0.87 into 250. This is the given data, and they have asked the question, find the depth of the neutral axis. The depth of the neutral axis is, four options they have given, A, B, C, D. We need to find the total depth of neutral axis. How we find the depth of the neutral axis? We put total C, total compressive forces are equal to the total tensile forces. If you put the total compressive forces equal to the total tensile forces, easily we can calculate the depth of the neutral axis. I know in the case of the doubly reinforced beam, how to calculate the total compressive force. I know how to calculate the tensile force in the doubly reinforced beam.
So first I'll be calculating the total compressive force, then I will put equal to the total tensile force. From there, I can calculate the depth of the neutral axis. So let's calculate. This is the given data. I know total compressive force is equal to 0.36 FCK B into XU plus A of SC into F of SC minus 0.446 FCK. This is the total compressive force, and it will be equal to total tensile force, that is 0.87 Fy into ST1 plus ST2. Right? I know the values. Let's put 0.36 FCK they have given. M20 means 20 newton per mm square. So FCK they have given me 20. B is 300 into XU plus this XU I want to find here. A of AC they have given 628. F of AC I know 0.87 into 250 minus 0.446 FCK should be equal to, this should be equal to 0.87 FI is 250 and total STD have given me 2200. So this term, second term is known, this third term is known, everything is known, only the XU is unknown. So we can calculate XU, and the answer is easily we can calculate XU, and the XU is equal to 160.91 mm. This is your depth of the neutral axis. So the answer is C. Your answer is C. So depth of the neutral axis we have calculated, that is 160.91 mm. Answer is C. Now the second question is, the moment of resistance of the section. The total moment of resistance we need to calculate here. We know how to calculate the total moment of resistance. The total moment of resistance of the doubly reinforced beam is equal to the moment of resistance taken by the singly reinforced beam, means the figure number 1, and the moment of resistance taken by, or the given by, AST2, the additional reinforcements that we know. So if we add these two values of moment of resistance, easily we can get the total moment of resistance of the given section. So let's calculate. This is the depth of neutral axis, 160.91 mm we got. So we'll be using this value for the further calculations. We should check here, actually, this XU, this section is your, this XU is actually your 160.91. We should check, calculate XU limit also, which is 0.48 into D. 0.48 into D, we know that is 500. So let's calculate and find whether it is under reinforced section or over reinforced section. So I'm getting the answer 240 mm. 240 mm, so definitely XU is less than XU limit. So it is my under reinforced section. So I can use this value only. Directly I can use this value in calculation of moment of resistance. Let's calculate the moment of resistance. The moment of resistance I know in the if I have to calculate in the compression zone, the moment of resistance is equal to 0.36 FCK B into XU into D minus 0.42 XU plus A of SC into F of SC minus 0.446 FCK into D minus D dash. This is the formula. So I can put here 0.36 FCK is your 20, B is your 300. XU we just have calculated, that is 160.91 into D we know, that is 500 minus 0.42 XU, again we have calculated 160.91 plus ASC they have given 628, then F of SC is 0.87 into 250 minus 0.446 FCK we know, that is 20, and D minus D dash, D is 500 minus D dash is they have given me D dash. That is the effective power for the compression reinforcement. That is 50 mm they have given. Please add these two terms. we can get the total moment of resistance for the given section, and it is equal to, and I am getting the answer, it is equal to 209.20 kilonewton meter. Means your answer is B. Your answer is B. So in this way, you have calculated the total moment of resistance given by the doubly reinforced beam for tension reinforcement of 2200 mm square and the compression reinforcement of 628 mm square. Please note down. And in this way, we have completed our doubly reinforced section chapter. Title actually, we have completed the topic of doubly reinforced beam. Today, we have discussed the singly reinforced beam, as well as the assumptions, the analysis of singly reinforced beam, and that how to design, how to provide the reinforcement, it also we have discussed. And we have discussed how to analyze the doubly reinforced beam, and also discuss how to design the doubly reinforced beam. Means we have seen how to provide the reinforcement AST1, AST2, and AFSC in the doubly reinforced beam. This calculation we have studied, and we have solved a number of gate problems. I hope you people enjoyed today's lecture. Thank you so much for today's lecture. Thank you.